A very good morning to you, our dear viewers and listeners. Thank you so much for joining us for the 8th edition of the Citizen Baraza. Like I have already said, Baraza is Kiswahili for a public meeting. And we shall be having our public meeting every Friday at 10 to discuss different government projects, programs, and interventions. My name is Duncan Abigaba, and I'm going to be your host. This morning, we have a very interesting discussion. It is trending right now, and I'm very sure it will benefit most of our viewers. We are discussing the loan scheme in Uganda. In 2014, the Higher Education Students Financing Board was established through an act of parliament to provide loans and scholarships to Ugandans. Among their objectives is to provide equitable access to higher education, to support Ugandans who are highly qualified but do not have resources, to ensure regional balance in education services, to support courses that are critical to national development, and to ensure a sustainable revolving loan fund. And this week, the executive director, Mr. Michael Wanyama, declared open the applications for loans and scholarships for the 2021-2022 academic year. And with us this morning, to shed more light on this is Mr. Bob Nwajera, the Senior Communications Officer at Higher Education Students Financing Board. Bob, you're most welcome.
Thank you. Thank you, Duncan, and good morning. And a good morning to those who are watching and listening us.
Thank you so much, Bob. By the way, I should tell our viewers that I'm sure some of you remember you from Makerere University. Poolside.
Sure. Prime time.
If you remember somebody who is to entertain us at prime time on the pool, Bob, but now he switched careers from entertainment to communication. Thank you so much, Bob.
You're welcome, Dan.
So we'll get into the heat of the moment, but before that, I want to tell our viewers that they will be able to send in all their questions in about 20 minutes.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah, so Bob, tell us, your boss, the executive director, has opened the applications for 2021-2022.
Yes.
So who is eligible to apply, and what requirements must one have?
Thank you, Duncan. The Higher Education Student Financing Board is a government support credit institution. We offer loans to students who want to access higher education. And you have elaborately talked about our objectives. I just want to pick out one, which is to support highly qualified Ugandans who want to access higher education, but are financially constrained, because we have three categories of groups of people at that level. One is a group which is able to pay for themselves, and that's okay. We have a group which is supported by the government scholarship scheme, so either merit or persons with a disability, sports, there is that group, and that group is about 5,000. Then we have the biggest majority, about 96% of the people who have qualified to study higher education are supposed to support themselves. So the board comes up to provide that gap. You want to study, but you are not able financially, given, you know, the increasing tuition. Now, who is eligible? I want to begin from the groups. Higher education in Uganda stops from senior six, starts at the diploma and at the degree. So, and it progresses with the postgraduates, that is masters and PhD. But in the current year, we will only be supporting the undergraduates. Now, that is someone who has finished a certificate and wants to study a diploma. That is someone who has finished a diploma and wants to study a degree. We are also looking for someone who has finished senior six and either wants to study a diploma or wants to study a degree. So those are the four categories that we are looking for this year. We have one other category that I will talk about later. So you must be at that level. So ideally, certificates is basic education. If you want to study a certificate, that's basic education. We are looking for someone who is studying a diploma and a degree. Secondly, you must be a Ugandan. This program is for Ugandans who are studying in Uganda. Thirdly, you must be admitted. So use your results to go to an institution, one of our listed institutions, and be admitted. You must have an admission before you come and say, I need help to study. But also fourthly, we have programs, as you highlighted in our objectives, programs critical for national development. Now, the national development plans, first, second, and third, have consistently highlighted programs which are key for national development. Looking at our national priorities, you look at agro-industrialization, you look at mineral development. These are key. So, but also the social sectors that have human resource gaps. And so health is one of them. Education is another. So generally, we support programs that are science, technology, engineering, and mathematics, what we call the STEM, the STEM programs. Yeah, so what people can generally call the science programs. So you must be admitted to one of those programs. Except on affirmative action, we allow persons with disabilities to take any course of their choice. Any program, whether in humanities or in business, they can take any program of their choice. The fifth thing in eligibility is also the institutions. We are sponsoring students who are going to study in chartered universities. Now, there is a difference between chartered and licensed. We currently have over 55 universities in Uganda, but only 22 are chartered. Now, all the public universities, what people call the government universities, are chartered. There are 10 of them. Then we have 12 private universities which are chartered. And I can run through them. You have, you know, Africa Bible University, you have Bishop Stuart University, you have Bugema University, you have ISBAT, you have Undeje, you have KIU, Kampala International University, you have Kampala University, you have Nkumba University, you have the Islamic University in Uganda, you have Mountains of the Moon University over there in Fort Portal. So we have about 12 of them which are chartered. So those are the institutions where our students study. Now, for what we call other tertiary institutions, we look at institutions which are diploma awarding but are for government. So think about all those institutions. I'm talking about the technical colleges, the Uganda technical colleges. We have three of them. We are talking about the colleges of health sciences. You know, Fort Portal College of Health Sciences, Murago Paramedical, these are colleges of health sciences. Nursing and midwifery institutions. Agriculture and conservation colleges. So, Bukarasa, Nyabyeya, Forestry College, the Fisheries Institute in Entebbe. These are the programs. So, at that level, the government other tertiary institution is where we sponsor programs. So, those are the five key points on eligibility. Maybe to add on one loan product which was brought this year, the continuing students loan. Now, for the continuing students loan, you must follow the rest of the eligibility that I've talked about. But the continuing students loan, because the fund for this year, the beginning fund, is smaller, the board decided, no, let's just gazette it for those who are in their final year and are stuck. So eligibility to the continuing students loan is going to only for this year alone be for finalists. So you are in your second year of a 2 year course, you are in your third year of a 3 year course, fourth year of a 4 year course, the longest is 5 years of a 5 year course, and you're stuck. That is the person that we are also looking for this year.
Wow, amazing. Yeah. So I think you've answered that question comprehensively. Mm-hmm. However, just run us quickly through the STEM courses, especially bachelor's level,
yes,
that you support.
Now, I want to say generally, when we categorize them into disciplines, they are about 10 disciplines. So every program, medical sciences, so under medical sciences, you have every course that falls under medical.
Bachelor of Medicine.
Medicine and Surgery, Pharmacy, Laboratory Technology, Clinical Medicine is on diploma, Anesthesia. So there are very many diplomas. You know, you can do anesthesia, you can do dental, you can do everything under medical sciences. We pay for everything under Computing and Information Technology. So computer science, software engineering, there are so many, cyber security, everything that is under agricultural sciences, agribusiness, agriculture and management. You know, Busitema University has a confluence of so many agricultural programs.
Yeah, irrigation and
all of them, as long as they are on diploma and degree, we are able to support. Every program that is under the natural sciences, so chemistry, biology, you know, physics, they are natural sciences. We have programs, education science, so mathematics. Now, even if it is mathematics and geography, for us, as long as there is a mathematics. There is also for these conservation programs, environmental science, you are thinking about forestry. So generally everything science, what we categorize as a science program, we will be able to support.
Yes. Yeah, so how do I apply?
Now, application process for the last 7 years has been the manual one, where we were partnering with a bank, and applicants would just go to a bank, pick a form, fill it, and bring it back to the bank. And we've done a transition. All institutions right now, you apply online to join these institutions. So we are also applying online. Go to our website, www.hesfeb.go.ug, you will see a big banner welcoming you to apply. And so you apply on, it's a very simple system, step flow. You can even use your phone to fill. You can even use your phone to take a picture of your attachments if it has a very good camera. So it's a very good system, very easy to use.
Yeah, so on the application system, is there like a drop down of the chartered institutions that you deal with?
Yes, we when you get to our system, first and foremost, we will welcome you with the requirements, that before you apply, these are the requirements. And the requirements also talk into the same eligibility criteria that I've talked about. You have a copy of your national ID, a copy of your result slip, a copy of your admission letter, and all of these things are provided. Then you enter. If you're a first year student joining in your first year, you have a portion. If you are a continuing student, there is a portion. So, and we are open for about 2 months. Opened up on Monday, October 11th, and closure is, the deadline is November 30th for people. So it's a big period. By that time, all universities will have finished their admissions and will have issued admission letters. So it is easier for people to be patient. You know, we have received calls, people saying, we have seen you open, but we have not gotten our admission letters. No, be patient. The time is wide.
Okay, so quickly run us through again the documents that you have mentioned.
Yes.
You mentioned them in passing,
yeah,
but now mention them with emphasis.
Yes.
For the benefit of our viewers and listeners.
For you to apply, and it would be very good for you to come with these things ready. One, have a copy of your national ID. Now, we understand that there is a group of people who have not received their national IDs, and they are in the process. So all we need is go to a registration center, at NIRA registration center, register for a national ID. Now, when you register, NIRA gives you a form. Photocopy that form. Now, if you don't have, even at that point, you don't have the national ID, you can use your former school ID. We will work with that for now. When you become a successful beneficiary, you must prove that you are Ugandan. The second bit is that birth certificate, we need your birth certificate. We need your parents' national IDs. Now, there are groups of people who must present additional evidence. If you are a person with a disability, and I'm saying this because we have affirmative action for persons with disabilities, please make sure that you have a form that proves that you are a PWD. If you're blind, if you are deaf, let it be there. If you are an orphan, if you have lost either or of your parents, make sure that you have a death certificate. We need it. It's very, very important. Please go to NIRA. It's 2 weeks. You will get it in 2 weeks. So if you are not able to, if time is not your best ally, we allow you to go to the LC1 chairperson to write for you a letter to us, but we shall verify it at a later stage. So those are the key documents. You have to draw for us a map to your home, and we have two maps you are requesting for. We are requesting for a map to your residence, current residence. If your current residence is different from your home of origin, you will give us two maps. So, and that is very key because there is a verification exercise that happens. Now, it is important for us to highlight the people we are also putting emphasis on. I've talked about persons with disabilities. We are looking for persons with disabilities. We know that they are there. And that's why we are supporting them to do any course of their choice. So if you know anyone in your neighborhood, PWD, and they finished and they, you know, most of them don't, they come from very hard backgrounds, let them apply. We actually give every PWD who applies. We give all of them. The second one, we have affirmative action towards the female applicants, the girl child. It's a government policy. And we are asking the girls to apply. There is an advantage that they have when they do apply. The third group is Northern Uganda. We have, in regional balance, it's one of our objectives. I can say balance the boat. We have noticed a trend of low applications from the greater north, but especially more in the Karamoja region. And so we have put up also a special and a very big consideration for students who are born and studied in Northern Uganda. You have a special consideration in the scorecard. Then we have extra slots for people who come from Northern Uganda. So we have a big one for Northern Uganda, especially the Karamoja region. And the two island districts of Karangara and Buvuma, the numbers are very low. And we know that basic education is improving, but we want people from that area also to apply.
Wow. So you have heard. Persons with a disability, it is automatic qualification for a loan or scholarship.
Yes.
If you come from Northern Uganda, had to reach areas of Karangara, Buvuma, and Karamoja, you stand a higher chance. And also, female students, please apply for this facility. You stand a higher chance. Yes, I have seen your statistics, and currently you're only 25%, 25.5 actually, female beneficiaries. So, yes, you have said you're giving them special consideration, but are you having like drives around or
yes.
any promotions that you're doing to make sure that you attract the girl child to services?
Yes, in also in consideration with other government programs like the equal opportunities consideration, we have improved. We moved from 25. We are now at 32%. At least we have hit the baseline consideration by the Equal Opportunities Commission. We, beginning with the financial year 2018-2019, that academic year, we started a raft of programs. and to attract the girl child. And you can see our trends, they started increasing. The numbers of the girls or the females who are accessing the scheme right now has grown to the extent that in the last academic year, 2020-21, the corona year, 45% of the beneficiaries were female. And we have enhanced it this year because we want to hit a 50%, that 50% of our up of the females, of the beneficiaries are female. And when you see in terms of performance, for us to hit 50%, then we end up giving 80% of the females who apply. So we have started a raft, and we're doing it on purpose because we have noticed something interesting. In recoveries, the females are performing much better. So these are good signs for us. And we are studying to find out why females are performing better than men in recoveries.
You know, they always say, if you want an office well run, then you give it to a woman. Chances of corruption, etc. are less. Okay. So it's the same thing now, same scenario in your work, that ladies are able to reimburse these loans, but the gentlemen, we always have many problems. So if I'm a PWD and I'm on your system applying, is there a provision for me to show that yes, I'm PWD?
Yes, we have a portion. When you, in the application process, when you tick, are you a PWD? First, we provide the provisions, the different provisions under PWDs, you know, blind, lame, and then we have a provision where you can attach either a picture. We have a place for the form, a medical form. There is a downloadable medical form. If you don't have one, we have a downloadable one. You can take a doctor and sign. But we also have a space for an extra evidence that you do. But interestingly, we, like other programs, we these are areas which we know the public knows are advantaged. And so we take keen interest, especially when we start the verification exercise, to verify all PWDs. To verify all who say they are orphans. So we take interest in some of these areas.
So I think I've read something where someone lied that they were an orphan,
yes,
and they were not. I think it's a Ugandan situation. So this brings me to a question. How do you do your due diligence?
We do our due diligence on different levels. We do our due diligence from our assessment when we are awarding the loans. Now, the loans are solely awarded by a non-human interactive system. It is called the Integrated Loan Management Information System. Now, what it grades from the information that has been provided, it grades. It's non-human. But we go on level two, where there is an assessment of those it has picked out to assess and see, have they provided the right kind of information. So our assessment is with the documents, the document bodies. So if it is the academic certificates or, you know, the pass slips, we are in touch with UNEB. If you say that you are an orphan, now part of the recommenders is a chairperson LC1, a chairperson LC3, and your former headmaster. These are all levels which we use in finding out. When someone tells us my school fees was 400,000, we confirm with the school that the school fees was 400,000. When someone tells us that my parents are dead, we even have the physical verification to your home area to see where your parents are actually buried. So we have different levels where we assess, and I think in our latest recently, so we it was unfortunate that 47 young people had to lose their slots on the scheme for falsifying information. So it is something that we want to warn the applicants about. Do not falsify information. And the sad thing about it was all those young people, when you look at their files, when their homes were visited, they are needy. They are needy. They didn't have to falsify anything. Mm-hmm. By virtue of their status, of their economic background, they would qualify. It was a sad predicament for us to also to, because it is policy. It is policy that, you know, someone who has presented wrong information, to help them earn an advantage, then they are disadvantaged.
They are disqualified. So, yes. Ladies and gentlemen, do not attempt to falsify anything. Yeah. Please provide facts. Facts will work to your advantage. Yeah. Misinformation will lead to your disqualification right away. Yeah, so our viewers and listeners, shortly, in less than 5 minutes maybe, you will be able to send in your questions on YouTube and Twitter spaces. So just hang on for around 5 minutes, then we shall go into our Q&A session. So, Bob,
yes.
Your mandate says you are supposed to give both loans and scholarships.
Yes.
But loans are prominent. So do you have any scholarships? Do you give any scholarships?
Currently, the framers of the law envisioned the board to be a one-stop center for higher education funding in Uganda. That is why the section, it should be section 36, that highlights the idea that loans and scholarships are under one docket. Now, we already had departments which were handling scholarships. The new thing here was giving out loans to students, and it was new and it's big, because that goes into credit administration. It is a new thing, because the dynamics are different from the commercial business. So government has focused much more on stabilizing credit administration to youth who have no job, who have nothing. So that's been the focus for the last 8 years. Now, the other government departments that were handling scholarships are still handling them. There is a scholarships committee at the Ministry of Education. There is we have scholarships in different places, and they are still handling for now. What we are strengthening right now is the loans, because it's a bank in essence. So bringing structures on board and making sure that everything is running up to recoveries, up to the revolving fund. When it has been stabilized, maybe then, but for now, we are running the loans.
Only loans for now.
Yes.
Yeah, so this is going to be my last question before I give an opportunity to the listeners and people who are watching us to ask questions, because I want that to take a bit of more time than we have taken. Yeah. Tell us about recovery. So far we see 11,800 beneficiaries,
yes,
of your program. Mm. I'm sure a big chunk of those have graduated and are working. Mm. So how is the recovery going?
Now this is how someone gets into recovery. How the student loan works is we pay for you for the time you are at in school. So we have a partnership with all these institutions. I will give an example. We have a partnership with Makerere University. So we communicate and say, Bob is a beneficiary of the loan scheme. So the loan scheme is the one which is going to be responsible for his tuition. So every semester, Makerere University invoices for Bob's tuition. Mm. That money does not go in Bob's pocket. That's a risk. That's a big risk. So we pay this money directly to the institutions. And then we pay for you until you finish. Mm. Now, when you finish, according to the policy, you are given a one-year grace period, 12 months. Now, that's for you to sit, settle, you know, find what to do, breathe in. And then policy also gives you twice your study period as the repayment period. So if you studied for a bachelor's of 3 years, education is usually 3 years, you are given 6 years to pay back this money. Then you add one of grace period, those are 7 years. Engineering courses are 4 years. So they are offered 8 plus 1, that is 9. The longest is medicine, it is 5. times 2, which is 10, plus 1 of internship, 11, then plus a grace period, 12 years to pay this money. So why I'm talking about this is, in it is different from the commercial loans. The commercial loans period is shorter. This is a social loan.
Have interest. Commercial loans have interest.
Yes.
Your support has no interest.
We do have interest. It is called value retention, to retain the value of money.
Oh, yeah.
Such that if we pay for you right now to do medicine, you see you are taking 12 years to pay us this money. If you start 2020 to pay this money, you'll finish in 2032. Mm. So we want if we give you 7 million to study, the money you'll bring then will also teach another medicine student, so such that money does not lose value. So we have a long repayment period. The average repayment right now in our system is 100,000 plus or minus. We have people who are paying 60,000 per month. 60,000, yes, because you see, you are looking at a medicine, at an education student, whose total loan in most of our universities, especially the public universities, the total loan is 6 million, and he has 7 years to pay 6 million. So that's about 80,000 per month if you amortize that across this period. So there is that kind of understanding that is needed. It is different from the commercial loans. So a long period of repayment, but also the small amounts that someone has to pay. 3,098 have finished school and have finished their grace period. Now, they will pay this, they have a total of about 30 billion, which we need to recover from them. And they will pay it between 6 to 12 years. So, of the number that is currently out in repayment, about 30% are consistently paying. Now, when I mean by consistently, I mean they are paying according to their schedules, but also some of them are paying much higher. Because if you are a medicine student, the moment you finish school, when you are on internship, your salary take home is 750,000. Now for us, we demand from you just 100,000 per month. So some of the students just decide, no, I will pay 300K. I will pay 500K. When they graduate and get on a job, they pay 2.5 basic. So it's a small amount, and some people are paying much higher. Then the 60%, some of them have asked for extension. The law allows that if a graduate or a beneficiary hasn't found income, now we emphasize income other than a job, because there are people in the private sector. So hasn't found income, you are able to communicate to us and tell us, I haven't found something to do, so reschedule my loan within the period. So reschedule my loan. So we reschedule. So the other 60% are either rescheduling or paying not so consistently. So, but there is, they are all in repayment. They have their schedules. They are communicating, and so that is good. But also we want to appreciate that young people appreciate this loan because they know it is a revolving fund. What they pay back is what takes their brothers to school. And so we have also seen a group that is working so hard to make sure that this loan is paid. We have people who have, you know, gone and gather money from all other sources and paid off this loan. And as I speak, about 30 students every week, we register about 3 students who are paying before even half their repayment period. They are paying back this loan.
That's patriotism.
Yeah, so we have about 30 students now who have completely paid off their loan. We have one window which many are taking advantage of. According to our policy, we have what we call early repayment. Early repayment is when you start paying back this money before the end of your grace period. So you are either a student or you are in the grace period. Now, this is what people are doing. They enter school, we stabilize the payments with the university, and then the parent or guardian, because they do not have capacity to pay all the money, the parent just commits to be paying back to the board maybe 100,000 per month. Now, if you are paying 100,000 per month, at the end of the year, you've paid 1.2. At the end of 3 years, you've paid 3.6. Now, for an education student, you've paid half. You've helped them to pay half of their loan. So, early repayment does not attract interest. any money that is paid before the end of the grace period does not attract any interest. So many of them right now are taking advantage of the early repayment window.
That's amazing. That's very amazing. And it's good to hear that there are some Ugandans who have a high sense of patriotic duty. They get these loans and are even able to pay within the grace period to offset the whole loan amount, and so that another Ugandan can benefit from this facility.
Yes.
So we are going into Q&A, where the viewers and listeners are going to ask you questions for the next 30 minutes. But if I go to Makerere University and I'm studying, you know, engineering, and I'm staying in a hostel in Chikoni,
yes.
So this hostel, who is paying?
Now, when the board or the framers of this law or the policy were putting it together, the beauty about us and the beauty about starting late was we sat down and studied from the countries that had been running this. There is, I mean, in the West, in Europe, and in, you know, in the West, student loans are the higher education funding policy.
That's how people study.
That's how people study.
Yeah,
you only have to take a loan.
Yeah.
In Africa, it is a little bit new, but some countries had been running it for quite some a while. Our neighbors in the East, Kenya has run the board since 1978. Yeah, so for them, we were able to pick up and learn some of the things. One of them is in efficiency. How do you make this little money efficient? One is, it was decided here that the loan scheme would be a cost-sharing initiative, whereby we will pay everything the university needs for you to study. Everything. Tuition, functional fees, research, graduation. We pay for everything. Internship. Then you cater for your welfare.
Mm.
It's hard to calculate what is comfortable for everyone in terms
sure.
of welfare. Yeah, because what's comfortable for one is not comfortable for the other. But also, two, with little money, you are able to pay for many students. So our unit cost right now is about 3.6 million per semester, unit, average unit cost. So we don't want to have a unit cost of 5 million per student, because that means we will pay for fewer students. But also finally, we don't want to give a big burden to the student, because if the unit cost was 5 million per semester, that means an education student would finish campus with a loan burden of 20 million. Now, this is someone who is starting out in life. They have a loan burden of 20 million. But for us right now, education students finish university with a loan burden of 6 million. This is something that you can pay in a period that we give you. So it is a cost-sharing initiative. You pay for your food. You pay for where you sleep. But in future, we are envisioning that they, even amongst the beneficiaries, there are those who are hard-pressed, that even accommodation, welfare, is such a big struggle. We have taken note, and the board is discussing to see how in the future this can also be supported through another, either offer them grants or give them also loans to cater for that part.
Yeah, amazing. Yeah, thank you so much, Mr. Bob Nwajila. We are still with Bob, the Senior Communications Officer at Higher Education Students Financing Board. And you now have an opportunity to ask your question or make a comment. But before you do that, I will sign out from here so that now the conversation goes online. Thank you so much for joining us this morning. My name is Duncan Abigaba. I have been your host, and we are here at the Government Citizen Interaction Center. Government Citizen Interaction Center is the primary contact center for you, a citizen in government. You can reach us through our WhatsApp line 0414-670-288, or you can send us an email at citizen@gcic.go.ug. Our toll-free line is still off, but you can also call us on 0414670558. So the conversation now goes on online. Ask your question, make a comment, and we will, Mr. Bob here, the senior communications officer at the Higher Education Students Financing Board, will answer you. Thank you so much.